All right, John, joining us now, the big get, Al Michaels. He's going to do his 11th Super Bowl on TV, tying Pat Summerall for the all-time record this Sunday. He's been honored by the Football and Baseball Hall of Fame. Do you believe in miracles? He's been in some movies. He's done it all. Marshan and Orion Sports Media Podcast. Al, thanks for joining us.
My pleasure, guys. I just hope the ratings don't tank now that I'm on.
We'll see. We'll see.
Al, my first question was about ratings. You're going to do a broadcast that's going to probably get over 100 million viewers. Do you get nervous? I'd be terrified.
You know, in a way, it's not nervous. I'm anxious. And I wish the game was tonight, frankly, because it's a long buildup, 2 weeks. This is day 8 as we take this right now. There's an anxiousness, not a nervousness. And one way I think I calmed myself down a number of years ago was somebody said, 100 million people are going to watch the game. Aren't you nervous? And I thought to myself, we live in a country of 330 million people. This also means 230 million people don't care and are not watching the game. So that's one way to put it in perspective.
Well, 100 million people means that there are a lot of people that are very casual fans and maybe not even fans at all. How does that affect how you call the game?
Well, you try to strike a balance. If you're getting deep into something that you know the football fan knows, you may approach it a little bit differently so that it's more understandable to the people who don't watch a lot of football. But then again, you never want to insult the people who do watch a ton of football. And obviously we know there are tens of millions of those. So it's a little bit of a balancing act where, you know, if you want to go, as I say, a little deeper, kind of bring it back so that the casual fan, the fan who only watches a couple of games during the season and the big games in postseason, understands it. But we've been doing this for a lot of years, and I think we've got whatever the template is, I think we've got it down.
11 Super Bowls is incredible. Al, do you have a favorite two or three calls from those 11?
Well, of the 10 prior ones, John, six of them, including the last four, have gone either down to the last play or the last several seconds. So we're hoping that run continues on Sunday. I would say if I had to pick one favorite telecast and Super Bowl, 2008, Arizona, what are they doing in there against Pittsburgh? But they go on a magical run, and Larry Fitzgerald's having a postseason for the ages. Kurt Warner is the quarterback against the vaunted Pittsburgh Steelers, who were favored in the game. And I know Dick Ebersol was the head of NBC Sports at the time, and he was apoplectic when Arizona got in. He says, oh my God, you know, who's going to watch the game? I said, Dick, can you see a couple coming down to a breakfast table on the morning of the Super Bowl? And the husband says, Zelda, the Arizona Cardinals are in the Super Bowl. Let's go to the movies. So I had to calm Dick down on that level. It turned out to be an unbelievably highly rated game. I think the highest Super Bowl rating at that point ever. The game was phenomenal. James Harrison, 100-yard run back at the end of the half. You've got Roethlisberger leading that charge at the end, the catch by Santonio Holmes. Larry Fitzgerald giving Arizona the lead with 2.5 minutes to play. The game was fantastic. And I thought John Madden, who I was ending my seventh year with, had as great a game as he's ever had. And I walked out of that booth, and there was a major afterglow. There was a great feeling. The crew was great. We had all the shots that we needed. And we walked downstairs and, you know, go out to the parking lot where the trucks are. I've never had a better feeling after a telecast than that. And of all things, 3 months later, what happens out of nowhere? I was shocked. John retires. And John just felt, and John was a man who could very concisely sum things up very quickly and right to the point. He said, it's time. And so John Madden, when you think about all the great things he did, he went out and as great as he ever was in the game that was my favorite game to televise.
First off, John, let me point out, when you said 11 years to Al, just classic Michaels making his partner look better there by saying, in the 10 I've done, very slyly. I don't know if the audience noticed that when you slipped up and said that he's already done 11. So notice that, Al.
We all need an editor in our life, Andrew.
Exactly. There you go. I mean, it was subtle. Sorry for pointing it out, John. That was my bad, but not as good a partner as that would be. You mentioned John. Now, you've said before, let's get to the good stuff. You've said that you don't want to retire. We understand that. You're still, I've written a number of times, still throwing 90, 95, hitting the black a lot. Just what are the circumstances? Why do you want to continue? What's the reasoning for, this obviously could be a swan song for you in LA, hometown, Super Bowl, it could be, but you want to continue. What's the reasoning behind that?
Andrew, I feel that I love what I do. I mean, I'm a kid who grew up in Brooklyn. My father took me to a Dodger game when I was 6 or 7 years old. This is all I ever wanted to do. And my dreams have come true tenfold. Gotten to do all the Olympics that I always wanted to do as a kid. World Series, did 8 of them. It seems like somebody else did those because none since 1995. Super Bowl never existed. And then to get to this point, I just love it. I love the people that I've worked with for a long, long time. There's a buzz. There's an excitement. I still get a kick out of going to the games and getting there early, and the crowd fills in and the music is going. I'm still excited by it. And I'm a sports fan at heart and always have been. And I have always loved sports, and it hasn't waned. And I'll never forget when I did the World Series in 1972 with the Cincinnati Reds. And I was on with Kurt Gowdy, and I loved Kurt. He was my first idol. And he said to me, kid, you're going to have a great career. Just remember one thing, don't get jaded. And I thought to myself, get jaded? How can I get jaded? I love this. But those words still ring in my ear, because I can see where in this business, some of the people that have worked in the business do get jaded, and they get bored or whatever. They're tired of the traveling. It's never happened to me. I love it. I love it as much as I've ever loved it. So thank God I'm blessed with good health. I feel great. I think the brain is still working fine. And I have opportunities to continue on. And I want to do it, because when people say retire, I'm going, retire to what? They say, you can play more golf. I say, I play enough golf. I don't have to do that. I love what I do, and I hope to be able to continue next year.
Now, I've reported Amazon has you at the top of their list. ESPN has considered making a run at you. And I know you're going to make a decision and really get into it after the Super Bowl. But when you think about this, what you want, when you look for, where you're going next, what is it that you want? 77, accomplished everything in your career. What is that you want in terms of when you look at your next place? And I think there could be a spot where you're working with NBC some with Amazon. But what are you looking for?
As usual, John, Andrew is totally wired. You know that, right? Totally. When Andrew calls me, I said, what's new in my life, by the way? Sometimes he has scoops for me. I think, Andrew, I think that I've got to have a team. You're out there, and you're kind of a centerpiece in a way, because people know you and they see you. But I think in this business, you need a great producer, director, and a partner. You've got to be able to work with somebody who you can feel very comfortable with and trust, and not only get along with, but just I've always said the game is the melody, and then the announcers provide the lyrics. So you got to make sure if you're in a duet or a band or whatever, that everybody is playing the same tune. So when I look to the future, I mean, that's going to be a big part of the decision-making process. And what's going to happen, because you're not out there on an island. You're just not. And you may be, as I say, you're front and center in a way, but you need a lot of support people with you, a lot of people behind you, a lot of people who know exactly where you're going and you're going with them. And I think that's going to be as important as anything right now moving forward.
Now, when you look at NBC, when they brought in Mike Tirico, the feeling was then that he would succeed Bob Costas on the Olympics, and then you're on play-by-play. Bob obviously chose to end his Olympics hosting duties. You've gone, I think, maybe longer than maybe Mike anticipated. And so how has that gone for you in terms of with NBC, and how everything's transpired in terms of what we haven't seen behind the scenes?
Yeah, well, maybe longer than some other people anticipated as well. And I know maybe somebody told me, he said, I've outkicked the coverage. Maybe, I don't know, but what do I know right now? All I know is I feel great and I want to continue to do this. I think when we brought Mike over, what NBC's plan was in 2016 was to have Sunday Night Football and Thursday Night Football, because CBS, I think, had the original Thursday Night package, and then CBS and NBC were going to split it in 16 and 17, and NBC's plan was to get it all in 18. So what happened? In 16, we brought Mike over. Our people were under the assumption that Mike was going to do Thursday, but the league said, no, no, we made the deal with you guys. We want the Sunday night crew. So Chris and I had to do the that part of the package in 16. We did double duty. In 17, Mike was able to come in. In 18, now you've got Fox that comes in, and they get the rights to this, and then there's no Thursday night. So, you know, Mike has spent a lot of time in the bullpen. And the irony is, too, here that, you know, I did 20 years of Monday night, and Mike did the next 10. So it's not like, you know, Mike doesn't have any experience doing primetime football. Anyway, that's kind of how the evolvement of this thing has gone. And as I say, maybe there's an outkicking of the coverage component here, but what can I tell you?
How important is the quality of the games that you're going to be doing? I mean, you're doing the Super Bowl right now. And one of the fears that I would have if I was you is going to Amazon, you'd be doing a lot of Commanders and Jaguars games.
Commanders against the Jaguars or separately? Yeah, I understand that. But, you know, it's funny. Sometimes you get a game, you go, wow, you know, it's two great teams. This is going to be fabulous. And the game turns out to be a dog. And other times you wind up with a game that doesn't look very good. And you go back over the Thursday night games on Fox this year. There were a couple of matchups that went, oh, that's not very good. And the games turned out to be great. So, you know, once you get on the air, you just forget about what the matchup is and you do the game. So, yes, I don't think there's any question but that on Thursday night, it can't be as quality driven, let's say, as a Sunday or Monday, where teams can make multiple appearances. On Thursday night, teams can only make, as of right now, one appearance per year. So it's a different kind of animal. But I would think with the amount of money that Amazon is going to pump into the National Football League, I think the league will do their best to give them as many good games on Thursday night as possible.
Now, Al, I'm Irish Catholic. So like my grudges hold grudges. When you left ESPN, you know, it was, you know, rather unceremonious. Fred was sort of kicked over to NBC. You and John sort of what went out that way. Do you still hold a grudge? I know those executives aren't there anymore, but the brand is.
No, you know, what happened was we were all under the Disney umbrella, and I was at ABC, and I'd been there for 30 years. And now ESPN comes along, and they're the upstart, and of course they become the worldwide leader. And then what happened was, when the new contracts came into effect in the 06 season, they thought at Disney that the best position to put Monday Night Football in would be ESPN. So I was, you know, completing my 20th year. We had a lame duck year in 05. Dick Ebersole came right after John Madden, right after him, immediately got John. He always wanted to have John. The season progresses, and Dick is able to get Fred Godelli and Drew Esikoff. ESPN wanted, you know, they wanted their people in there. There was this whole, you know, kind of thing about, hey, you know, we're taking over and the ABC guys are the outlier. Now it's our show. So I got caught in the middle of that. I didn't want to have to do Monday night on ESPN. I couldn't make a deal with Ebersole after we'd gotten Godelli and Esikoff. Now he's got Madden, Godelli, and Esikoff. And I've got to go over there because those are where my guys are. And I went to them. I don't hold any grudges because I went to the folks at Disney and I said, look, I said, I'd appreciate it if you let me out of my deal because it's better for both of us. You've got certain ideas about how you want to do Monday Night Football beginning in 06. They don't really blend with my ideas. You know, my people are all over at the other place. So we effected we arranged a deal where ESPN and Disney got certain rights to Ryder Cup events and more Olympic coverage and all that. And then, of course, at the end of the day, we threw in that lucky rabbit, Oswald, who became the star of the show at that point. So to this day, what can I tell you? I've got all these
the headline posters, writes itself out.
Posters and rag dolls with the little Oswald, who looked like Mickey Mouse.
I actually have, I wish I had it with me. I'm in LA already for the Super Bowl. I have an Oswald the Rabbit shirt, and our dog is named Oswald after Oswald the Rabbit because my kids love Disney. That's more the reason. That's how we tied that in. But here's my thing. How do you feel about that Oswald the Rabbit part of it? Because that has become a part of sportscasting lore.
Love it. I mean, it's in a way, part of the thing. Look, the deal was done. It was done before Oswald. And then I got a call from a top executive at Disney. You ever hear of Oswald the Lucky Rabbit? No. Well, the Disney family, the Disney heirs, want to get him back with us. So I go, yeah, so? Well, what if we threw Oswald into this deal? I go, fine. So, of course, naturally, otherwise it would look like some sort of an insidious thing was going on behind the scenes. I was breaking a contract, whatever. So instead of it looking like something that was untoward, Oswald became the joke. And Andrew, you also know, you brought up the fact that you know, Oswald looked like Mickey Mouse. So the biggest joke was played by Walt Disney when he was told he couldn't take Oswald with him. And then he made a mouse look like a rabbit. I mean, think about that. You put the two of them together, they came out of the same womb, I'm telling you.
It looks exactly the same. The question is, would Disney World have been as successful in Disney overall if it was Oswald the Rabbit instead of Mickey Mouse?
Great question. I know nobody can answer that, but that, you know, would a rabbit have superseded a mouse, or a mouse superseded? I don't know. That's a question for the ages, though.
Exactly. A couple of quick hitters as we finish up here. Just, we have you on. Got to ask, what your best Cosell story? If somebody, you're at a party, someone says, Howard Cosell, Al, what's your best story? What can you tell us on a podcast that's listened around the world?
Well, I mean, the classic Cosell story is, we're in Kansas City, we're doing a baseball game just before the strike in 81. The Yankees are coming to town, and I get to town on Sunday night, and Howard calls my room and he says, Alfalfa, a name he stole from Bob Uecker. Uecker gave me that name. What are you doing? Nothing. Meet me in the lobby at 6 o'clock. We're going to dinner at the Savoy Grill. Okay. We have, and in those years, you had the longest limousine in town belonged to ABC. So it's a long white limousine driven by a woman by the name of Peggy, who'd been driving all of the ABC people for 30 years. We go downtown. Howard drinks an aquarium's worth of vodka. And also, when Howard was on the road, he'd always have the yellow blazer. He's got the toupee, of course, and a cigar. So, and Howard loved being noticed. He's sitting in the Savoy Grill and everybody's coming over. We finish up and we get into the limousine, and now we're going through Kansas City, an area just off downtown. It's dusk. And then we come to a stoplight. And Howard looks off to his, he's sitting the left in the back, left seat. And he looks across the street and there are two kids having a fight, a serious fight. And five or six other kids are, you know, egging them on. Next thing you know, Howard opens the door and gets out onto the street and starts to walk toward them. And Peggy screams, Mr. Cosell. Meanwhile, you know, I'm trying to grab him. I can't. He's already gone. He's on the sidewalk. And at that point, no cell phones. Can't call a cop. You can't. I don't know what's going to happen here. I've got two young kids, so I can't save him. And Peggy's dying in the front. So meanwhile, the fight stops. You've got six or seven kids who just have their mouths open. And it just stops. It's suspended animation. And then Howard says, okay, listen up. It's quite apparent to this trained observer that the young southpaw does not have a jab requisite for the continuation of this fray. Furthermore, his opponent is a man of inferior and diminishing skills. This confrontation is halted post haste. So I'm in the car. Peggy is going crazy. And meanwhile, thank God, now you got the moment of truth. Are they going to jump him or they know who he is? Howard Cosell. They start dancing around him like he's a maypole. Somehow a writing utensil gets produced. He signs a couple of autographs on their shirt, comes back into the limousine. Okay. I'm thinking, can you imagine these kids going back and trying to explain it to the people that they live with? So the limousine takes off. It was so crazy that I was speechless. Peggy was speechless. She drives away. She drives about two blocks. We come to a stop sign. Peggy looks into the rearview mirror and says to Howard, Mr. Cosell, excuse me, I've been driving for 30 years. I've seen everything. I've never seen anything like that. And Howard leans back. He's got the cigar going, takes a drag, and says, Pegaroo, just remember one thing. I know who I am. And that is, I can't do any better than that with Costa. I've got a few stories, but that takes the cake.
That's amazing. Just give us the Al Gore story, if you can, like a quick version of the Al Gore story with the phone, if you can.
Well, Christmas 2000. So I'm in Tennessee. We're in Nashville doing the Titans against the Cowboys. This is post-election. Meanwhile, you got the hanging chads out there. Who won the election? It's Bush against Gore. And I'm having a problem with my phone in the room on the top floor of the Lowe's Hotel across from Vanderbilt. The guy comes up there, oh, you know, we've had all kinds of trouble since Gore was here on election night. They took over the whole top floor, screwed up the phone system. Okay. So I'm thinking, well, Gore was down the hall, probably. The big suite belonged to Bud Adams, then the owner of the Titans. And we come back from dinner. It's Christmas Eve. And I see that the door to the suite is open. So I knew Bud. And I was going to go in, hey, you know, Bud, your door is open. Merry Christmas, whatever. So nobody's in there. So I walk in and I see there's a phone on the coffee table. And I'm thinking, they probably had secure phones, but maybe this was the phone that Gore used to concede to Bush before, you know, everything went crazy afterwards with the hanging chads. So I just unplugged it and I took it. So I'm a kleptomaniac. I'm a junior kleptomaniac, but I had to have that somewhere in the garage.
Listen, Al, good luck this Sunday, Super Bowl on TV number 11. Good luck after trying to figure out your future. If it's Amazon, if it's ESPN, listen, I don't want to speak for John. If those don't work out, it could be Marchand, Oran, and Michaels.
We have a sports spot. Media
podcast. I know. Absolutely. You live on top billing. We'll have to discuss that. But if it doesn't work out with anybody else, you could talk media every week.
Andrew, you'll be the guy to call me to tell me what my next move is. I'm counting on it.
Let's hope for you it's not with Marchand and Oran. That would not be. That means it didn't work out well.
This is fun. A lot of fun.
Great. Thanks, guys. Al.